Hi, my name's Neil Bubke, and this is Mae Mobley, and we'd like to welcome you to the last of our summer live stream concert series. This evening, you'll have the privilege of hearing Adam Nelson on horn and David Hein accompanying on piano. Adam recently graduated from the studio of Greg Flint at UWM and will continue with his studies in Milwaukee this coming fall. David has recently been serving as a choral director at Marion University and has accompanied professionally throughout Wisconsin. He's also the principal organist here at the United Methodist Church of Whitefish Bay. We hope you enjoy the concert tonight.
Thank you. That first piece I just played was Bozza sur la Chimes. Bozza was a French impressionist composer, early 19th century. He wrote a lot of pieces for jury pieces for the French Conservatory, including that one. This next piece is Mozart's second horn concerto. Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a little conversation with Adam and learn a little bit more about the instrument you're playing. First of all, Adam, is it called horn or is it called French horn?
I always go with horn. Some people will get real upset if you say French horn, so I always go with horn.
Can you give us a little bit of insight into this naming issue?
Yeah, well, it's not really French, and I think that's probably where a lot of the concern comes in. More German roots, but I think it's just kind of a thing that we got, maybe.
So I've been reading a lot of articles about choral singing and the spread of aerosols because of the pandemic that we're in, and one of the articles I talked about mentioned the horn and how all of the tubing in the horn actually helps minimize a little bit the amount of aerosol that's spread. Do you happen to know if we stretched it out completely about how long the horn would be?
My horn's gonna be about 14 feet. You got a couple different kinds of horns, so if you're in fifth or sixth grade, you're probably playing a single horn. Even through middle school, you might be on a single horn. Single horn is gonna be closer to 12 feet. But if you got a double horn, that means a B-flat side and an F side, that's gonna add a couple extra feet of tubing. If you're real advanced, you got a triple, then you got two nice things about that. One, you got a little bit extra tubing. Two, you also got a little easy button to make the high notes pop out. My professor's out there shaking his head. He says that's not true.
So I think the opposite of a triple would be a natural horn. Can you tell everybody at home what a natural horn is and how you can identify that?
Yeah, a natural horn would be a horn without any valves. That's how the instrument was originally created. I can imagine a bunch of people, it was originally made as a hunting horn. So you're on horseback and you want to signal your other horse riders, hunters. You'll pull out your horn and play, toot some notes for them, and that can signify, but you know, you don't need a bunch of valves for fancy stuff for that. You just want to have a big horn that can wrap around your body. So that's where the natural horn came from. Then eventually Handel came in and said, hey, let's throw that in the orchestra and see what happens. And at first, wasn't too great. There were some people who weren't too happy about that. But eventually it came around, and now it's one of the more beautiful instruments in the orchestra, in my opinion.
So natural horn versus horn with valves. The Mozart concerto you played, was that originally conceived for a natural horn or a horn with valves?
That would be for natural horn. So if I wanted to, I could play everything just with this first valve down. In other words, I'd put in a different crook, an E-flat crook, and that would make my horn in the key of concert E-flat, and I could play everything on that Mozart without using any valves. What I would have to do is use my hand to cover up some notes and bring some of the notes down.
So if David, your accompanist, is still close, do you want to do one of the movements? Just do it as natural horn? Just kidding. All right. So one thing I didn't mention in Adam's introduction today is that he's been a faithful member of this church and singing in the choir for the past couple years, so I know I can rib him, and he always takes it really well. So Adam, in your capacity as a member of the choir, you've had the opportunity to conduct a little bit, and I'm just curious to know how, as a musician, how you would describe the differences between being an ensemble member or conducting.
Yeah, well, first I'd like to show my appreciation for having the opportunity to serve as a choral and conducting scholar for the last year and a half or so. That's been a great opportunity, and especially that conducting aspect of it. It's helped me a lot. It also helps my musicality, as Neil mentioned. I get kind of the what it's like to be on the other side and why some of the conductors are showing things that they are. It makes sense when I'm doing it a little bit more why what I'm looking for, and that's going to help me when I'm in the ensemble. If I see something, I might know what they're looking for a little bit more.
Well, before we take a couple minute break and give Adam an opportunity to get some more water and rest his lips before the second half of the program, I just want to ask you if you have any favorite recordings of famous horn players that you'd recommend for people at home to look for on iTunes or Spotify if they want to continue listening to some great horn playing.
Well, I grew up in the Midwest, and the Midwest standard would be the Chicago Symphony Orchestra. If you look up Chicago Symphony Orchestra, I can tell you there's going to be some good horn playing on that, starting from Philip Farkas, who actually designed this horn that I'm playing. Technically, the Holton 180 model is a Farkas model. And then he didn't design it himself, but he had some say in it, out of the Elkhorn factory. And after that was Dale Clevenger. He was the next guy who had a long tenure, and he just retired in 2013, and now we've got David Cooper, who's a new guy in there and doing some really exciting stuff. So if, my personal favorite out of Chicago, this came from a suggestion from my professor, is Giolini conducting Mahler's Ninth Symphony, and that's got some real beautiful horn playing in that. And that was during the Clevenger era.
Yeah, the Mahler Nine, I think, might be one of the only orchestral pieces that has an extended flute horn duet in one of the movements.
I played that excerpt many times, yes.
Well, thank you, Adam. For those of you watching at home, we're just going to take 3 or 4 minutes. We're going to keep the computer live stream rolling so you don't have to log back in. But we'll give Adam a minute to get some more water and rest his lips, and then we'll resume the concert. So stay tuned.
The next piece that we've got up is Fanfare for Barks by Kerry Turner, who's a 20th and 21st century composer, primarily for horn. He's affiliated with the American Horn Quartet, for whom this piece is written. We are playing it. We are the UWM undergraduate horn quartet, and I hope you enjoy. After that, I will, the next piece after that is Intermezzo by Pills.
Thank you.
This next piece up is a piece originally written for two euphoniums and horn. I heard it while I was at a brass program out in Denver last summer. played by Demondre Thurman, and I was super impressed by his playing and thought that it might translate well to horn. So it's called A Song from Wales by Tom Devoran. I'm joined by Andy Slembarski, who was a classmate of mine at UWM my freshman year. Now he is the director of bands at MSOE. This is Song for Wales for two horns and piano.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Adam, David, and the rest of the horn players who collaborated tonight. We really appreciate it. It sounded wonderful. And thanks to everybody at home for tuning in to this concert and the rest of the series. During this last piece, I had an aha moment and thought that we should recognize our sound techs. Mary Paul and Tim Karth, come forward, please. Without you, we wouldn't have been able to do our live stream series. All right, so they're reluctant to come forward tonight, but because of that, I'm going to be posting some candid shots of Mary Paul and Tim Karth on the internet. So come back to the church website, and I'll get them back for not coming forward tonight. Anyway, thanks again, Adam. We really appreciated it. And thanks to all of you at home for tuning in. See you later.